and we meant for it to be that way, in some ways you self-select your pace, because you can choose whether to go to some things or not. But we know we've got a very short period of time, and you came here for a reason. You didn't come here to rest. So, you know, we're just going to keep, we're going to keep the trains going, and you got to decide when you got to get off the train, okay? So you got to decide, but we're going to keep them going. Now, we do urge you, we do very much want you to contribute photographs, pictures of whatever it is you've got. Vicki is doing a photo site on NewsU.
I'm working on Photopalooza.
Photopalooza? there is no limit to the number of paloozas we can do, right? So you'll instruct us where to send that stuff?
Yes, sir.
Did you trademark the name?
So,
if you don't want the world to see you...
Well, we actually have the URL, that's for sure. So and we already know that we're going to do Teachapalooza 2012, so we'll have more to say about that later. The one thing that I didn't say to you when we got started is that there will be a questionnaire for you available. We'll ask you to do some feedback to us after you get back. So we'll have that up on the NewsU site, but we very, very much will be soliciting your feedback so that we can think about how to make 2012 even better and attract even more people. We want this to become a destination for you annually, frankly, as opposed to some of the seminars that we do where you might come once and then never come again. Our idea here is to constantly change content so that you will constantly be able to come to a place during the summertime, get jazzed up and ready for the fall semester with the newest, coolest thing. And someday we'll all be as cool as Rick. And then, all right. My job for the next hour and something is to talk about what it all looks like when we start putting all of our new learning and technology together. And I think the most important question is, can we actually improve journalism if we use all these tools that we're talking about learning? I mean, it's one thing just to do it and get a bigger audience, but can we improve journalism in the process? And I want to stipulate that I think the answer is yes. If we mean to improve journalism and not just increase audience, and increasing audience is huge. But if we also want to improve journalism, I believe if we use the tools that we're talking about this weekend, if we use them correctly in the process, we'll actually tell stronger stories. And that's what we're all about. Teach it?
Teach it.
I was going to say, teach it. All right, so I do think that, and I want to try to demonstrate that in the things that I'm going to show you. Once again, if you want this presentation or any parts of it, I make it freely available. All you got to do is hand me your thumb drive at the end of it, and I'm glad to knock it over or give you any pieces of it. It's totally yours.
Can you put it up on the website?
It's probably too big for that. To be honest with you, it's probably going to be too big for that. That's the reason why we told you to bring those thumb drives. Or I can knock it straight over to your machine if you want. Okay? But you may just want individual pieces of it, and I'm happy to do that. Whatever is ours is yours. If I knew how to say it, it'd be sort of like the equivalent of mi casa, su casa, me presentation. All right, so one story told seven ways. I'm going to start with this project from the Las Vegas Sun. This site is still up, so after we finish, you go back, you'll be able to actually look at this piece in its raw form. And if you want to, I'm happy to dive into it and take a look at pieces of it while we talk.
Something. 90% of us in this room face the exact opposite. We're moving from an island-based method of educating people where each of us is our own little silo. We do what we want. We've got all the power associated with that. And we're trying to teach collaboration in an anti-collaborative environment. That's why these curricula are stuck in the mud. So, where could we find that inspiration to go back into these curriculum meetings and with our colleagues and say, look, this is a new way that we could engineer the systems within our environment to move forward.
I mean, one thing I would suggest, and this is, it's still a fairly rare media organization that has figured this out, because to make this work, any legacy organization is organized around its original core functions, right? So technology was a separate function that somebody else owned. And product development didn't even exist, right? So when you needed designers, you went to your editorial designers, not to people who understand interactive design. And these things tend to be siloed in media organizations, and different people control them, so the IT group is all worried about all the different projects that, different parts of the organization are pushing down on them, right? And they can't, they really don't care what you're trying to build, they just care about the deadline. So some of it is an internal organizational thing. I would say the Times has pretty much gotten this right and is pretty far along in doing this. We are, there are probably some others out there that I'm not aware of, but a lot of them are working in a very linear fashion. If you can find places that are working like this, I think as educators it's worth actually just seeing if you can spend time, and if not in a media organization, then out in Silicon Valley at some startups, watching how this process works. We've actually begun, there's one of the sort of surprising offshoots of this is we've begun using this technique internally for things that have nothing to do with web development. We've had a few communications issues to deal with, right? So we've gotten teams of people together to collaborate and do some thinking around things like that in these sort of rapid cycles. And to, it's one of the things that's valuable about it is that the people who typically own the process, the ultimate stakeholders, set the agenda or are involved in setting the agenda going in, but then have to stand back. And you know, there are real rules around this. Can't have your Uber manager coming in and trying to muck with things, right? They gotta wait until it comes out 2 weeks later on the other end and you get a chance to review it. And, you know, and if you're not happy with it for various reasons, you can circle back around. But it empowers people to find solutions on their own. So a first step would just be exposure, I guess. I've heard questions who had a long history around this and they've thought about it. And that kind of institutional knowledge, I think, is at risk. And I don't know what's going to replace it. I mean, in terms of how we deal with it, we're still organized in a fairly conventional way. We've got people who've been there 40 years. We've got, you know, ranks of editors that read back on stories and so forth. And there is a culture that encourages discussion of ethical issues. We're going through as a result of some of the stuff we've been through in the last 6 months. Bob Steele, who used to be here at Pointer, has been working with NPR to take a fresh look at primarily our journalism ethics, though it's the conversation is actually extending to the entire organization, because now the public doesn't distinguish necessarily between an NPR employee in finance who puts something on their Facebook page or a bumper sticker on their car from a journalist who does so. And so that's part of the conversation we're having internally about how do you balance the some of the compromises that journalists readily make for the privilege of being able to report against what will seem to other employees as an infringement on their freedoms. It is available. I mean, it creates an opportunity. It opens up the program today. You can get beyond the limitations of the broadcast signal on a 24-hour clock. But it also opens the door to all kinds of people who want to do audio and kind of barriers to entry just too high in traditional broadcast.
Well, NAB is pressing for federal legislation to require help.
Instinct is to let the market grab that. I think we will, it feels a little bit like an industry wanting to hang on to its legacy assets and make sure that they find their way into new technologies, as opposed to really thinking about how are people going to consume news information. Certainly as a transitional technology, where there's still either cost or bandwidth limitations attached to some extent audio delivery, but certainly video delivery over the internet, there may well be some value to that. But I think people are very quickly learning that control over their media is something they really want, and so just having that FM transmitter trip in the smartphone is not really satisfying enough.
That was a question, Dan.
5 flight. You have a 5 o'clock flight. You have a 2 p.m., you know, 2 in the morning flight, in which case you get there by yourself. But I will make the arrangements and talk to you about it before or by lunch.
And you want us to write it on our list of
to write it next to your name.
And put it on that little pedestal.
Right here.
At the end of this first session, and she will have it.
Okay, now if there are no changes and you don't need a cab, just X so that I know that I have everybody. Okay, is that really clear? It's not clear?
We turn that in no matter what. Is that clear?
Correct.
Okay, that is clear.
Right.
No matter what.
Okay.
It's a little system she has worked out. Okay.
And it works really well.
Is there more, Ms. Nissenbaum? There'll be lunch here. You've been cooking all night, I hear.
Yeah, there was lunch. I already talked to her. I said, yeah.
Okay.
Fabulous one.
Jeannie Nissenbaum, the queen of all media. Okay. Sarah and I and Vicki, we've been talking. How many of you are going to leave before 3:30? Okay. We think we're going to do something a little bit unconventional, and that is that we're going to allow you to graduate prior to actually having finished the coursework. Yes. Well, some of you are going to graduate. A few of you will have to come talk to us in a little while. Okay, but we'll get away. So we're actually going to have a little graduation during lunch to make sure that we get to everybody who's eligible, okay? So if you don't get your certificate at lunch, you'll understand you weren't quite satisfactory. Right. Is that cool for everybody?
Yeah. Also, the pepper here.
Right, exactly. Anybody from parents? Is that good? Now, Katie stayed up all night last night and printed in her dark room. Actually, she turned out all the lights and made people a little picture, so that was nice of Katie. Isn't that right?
That's right.
And the last thing is, I was talking to some of you following Katie's session yesterday, apparently you weren't aware that she's robotic. She's not real. So that takes a little pressure off of you. You don't have to do this because she's just a figment of your imagination. Nobody works like this. Everybody give it up for Katie Comper, right here.
All right. So, you know, the people who really do journalism and teaching effectively don't tell, they show. So as a wrap-up for my Twitter session, I want to show you two things that are ablaze this morning on Twitter. Look at the movement on a hashtag that's pound blame for Muslims. It's the worldwide number one leading trend on Twitter right now, but it's almost entirely complaints about why blame the Muslims is trending on Twitter. It's all these people who are promoting a hashtag to complain about that hashtag. That's how the circle can work. Then over here is another hash. It's a really, really interesting situation right now. Jeff Jarvis, who any of you follow Jeff Jarvis?
Yeah, I got him.
Jeff can be a little cranky. but also very, very interesting. Jeff started a hash last night. You'll have to pardon my language here. He started a hash last night, found fuck you, Washington, and then four, and asked his followers to fill in after the four. And people began to do F you, Washington, for making me more worried about my disabled sister than I already am, for getting in bed with corporations, and they're left, right, center, they're all over. And overnight, it began to trend upward. So here's what it started doing last night, and then it started trending downward. But people who were on the hash were like, great, it seems like there's more activity. Then the hash became, wait a minute, is Twitter suppressing it because it's not showing up as a worldwide trend? But this is the trend map. It's obliterating. It's obliterating the United States, but it's also worldwide. It's all over the place. But it's not coming up as a leading trend on Twitter, which has now led to the pound FU Twitter or Twitter pound Twitter censor, ? Because they're wondering if it's being censored. Jeff is getting what's called rate limited on Twitter. There's too much activity, and Twitter may be suppressing it because it has profanity in it. So that's something I'd watch today. It's a Sunday. It's a slow news day. You might get a little mainstream media action out of it. But this is Twitter in action, the kind of stuff that you can show at the beginning of a lecture and look cool. All right. So from looking cool to pulling your hair out, let's move into how to move a curriculum forward.
Congratulations, my dear.
You know, I have to say one thing, and that is eat more blue cheese. This is my first time at Quiner. I've had a great time. It's been so nice to meet everybody. And hope to be here again sometime. Next person is Sandra Elko.
Deborah Chung.
This is my first time at Clarion Fair, and I've learned so much and taking a whole bunch of tools with me, and I've met so many super people here, so thank you so much, and I hope to keep in touch and return. Sue and Christian.
This is your brainchild. I think Teachapalooza has legs. I think hope that it continues to go on and on. And thanks to all the nice people who gave me lots of information and shared their knowledge. It was nice to see Kenny and some of the pointer staff that I got to know 2 years ago at Diversity Plus Curriculum. So it's great to be back here. And I hope that keep connections with this great community of people. So thanks.
Pointer faculty and all the instructors who participated. You guys are awesome, and it was great having dinner every night with at a new restaurant. let's see. Richard Brunson.
This place is an oasis, and it just nourishes my soul every time I come. So thank you to the faculty and staff. And for everyone that I've met in all the whole conversation, I appreciate you making me a smarter teacher. So thank you very much. And the next person is Lori Gross. Lori.
Thank you very much to everyone here, and also what I said the first day I came here. I want to work. So thanks very much, and I shall be back. This is my first one, but I will hopefully come back again. Dave Boswick.
I'm actually not graduated because I have to stay around for the next couple of days, so I guess that makes me either a fifth-year senior or A. Joe Borrell.
Thank you. This is my second time at Poynter. One thing I learned during my first time here, I was with two other folks when we did diversity, is I always come here with like, that's something I need to work on. I've been working on curriculum in the last year, diversity, and other things we're working on. If you guys want to do a third one, maybe on assessment, assessment, another sort of challenge. That might be something else that you would come down to St. Pete for. It's been great. It's wonderful having this support group of other folks who are wrestling the same challenges you are. It just feels good to talk to other people. And I always feel better at the end of a couple of days here at Poynter. That's really a great, great thing. All right, continuing on. John Deacon.
This is my first time down here, although I did do a writing workshop up in Delaware probably 5 years ago. Nothing I can imagine less coming down for than an assessment workshop. I did make a short one last year with the administration, and I got to meet with an assessment guy who explained how, yes, his rubric tells you nothing about the writing of the individual student, and yes, a person who can't write a sentence that he can make any sense of can get a full passing on his assessment instrument, and that's why it's great. Mm-hmm. And I am glad to avoid assessment. Leticia Anderson.
Thank you.
fun to be here and to meet you all, and I really hope we stay in touch. I know there's the listserv, so let's make sure to actually share the ideas that we started sharing this weekend. Thank you. Michael.
So it's actually true, but as I always tell people, I don't care if it's spelled correctly or the check. I'm a Frosh here, and I hope to come back next year. Given the fact that I'm starting a doctoral program this fall at my tender age, we'll see what happens. But taking a lot back, I'd like to see my fellow faculty members of the Fender team come down here if you can. So we're going to do some sort of fundraiser to come down here next year. We'll see if we can get down here. So thank you.
For $49.99, we'll make your PhD.
Wow, Tops. Well, this is my second time. I was here once before as a teacher in the Sports Journalism Institute, and I was able to offer some there, but I think as a student, I got a lot more back than I gave to those students a couple of years ago. So I came here because I wanted to really get almost an introduction to multimedia journalism. And this has been like a 2-day, 3-day survey course, which is exactly what I needed. So thanks very much for the conversation and for what I learned. Oh. Lisa Taylor.
I'm just glad to be going home, and not for the reason that you might think, because I've said that and meant it in very different ways, but I can't learn anymore unless I attach an external hard drive to my brain stem. It's just all full, and I have to go use it before I just lose it. How about an informal, here's my low-tech version of Poll Anywhere. Who's coming back to Teachapalooza 2012? If you're the ones that could, it'll be great to be back here. It was tremendous. Thanks to faculty and staff. It was just amazing. And me. Tom Story.
I echo that thought. I was going to say when my 13-year-old daughter often says to me late at night, she says, "Daddy, my brain is full." And it really is. So I hope to empty it very quickly and put it in use. This is my second time at Pointer. First time on a hands-on workshop. The other one was back in the 90s with an ethic workshop. But actually, my involvement goes back before Pointer was Pointer. When it was called the Modern Media Institute, it operated out of a little bank building over on Central, okay? And back in, that was 1980, I spent a fall here with what they called media management program. I never got into media management, thank God. But I saw then the potential, and Roy Clark was a youngster teaching then, some of the folks at the St. Pete Times have been involved, and I've known Al for a number of years now, and it's been great to meet the other Pointers and all of you this weekend. Thanks. Graham Speckline. Yeah.
It was typical for Pointer because we were standing there with personal camera equipment
that Mike Mount had lent us so we could do take some photos on the beach. And there was this huge storm coming in as we were standing there. I posted it on Facebook this morning. It's a little hard to see, but what was magnificent for us is we were standing there and we saw this huge, powerful, beautiful thing coming toward us, and we were kind of in awe. We were a little afraid we were going to get hit by lightning. But that's how I feel when I leave Pointer. I'm overwhelmed, but I'm excited and I can't wait. So. Thank you very much to the staff and the faculty, of course. And yeah, it's great. Before I sort of had time to work on my syllabus for the fall, I thought, you know what, I'm going to come here and get some good ideas. And now I'm like, wow, I've got to go through all this stuff because I need to be working and feel very recharged. So thank you. Next person. Alan Shear.
Thank you for coming to my bar mitzvah. This is my second trip to Compton, and my wife always wonders, why would anybody want to go to the St. Pete in the summer? And I said, well, basically, I walk in there dragging my ass. They inspire me so much that I leave doing cartwheels. My only suggestion is, next summer, hold it in Glacier National. Thank you. Next is Buck Ryan.
I'm Buck Ryan from the University of Kentucky. My first visit to Pointer was in 1989, and I remained in the remedial class. That's a tribute to Pointer as a fountain of inspiration and ideas. And so, thank you to everyone. Doreen Robinson.
Dear Fight, this is my first year here. I've never felt so stupid in my life, given the power to get myself smarter. Thank you very, very much. Next name is James Robertson.
Whenever you get something using your indirect name, you know they don't know you.
Right.
20 years of service to the university, James Robertson. I said, you haven't really noticed me yet. Thank you, Pointer. My dean will not thank you because I'm going to go back and ask for money, the services, and all kinds of things that he is not going to want to give us.
Right.
So I'll list you guys as correspondents if my dean and I have a divorce.
You're not letting me come up?
Oh, this is you, right?
No, I'm James Robertson. No, yes, Repert.
Come on over here.
Thank you, ma'am.
Stop working and come over here. Congratulations. You just hold on a minute.
Okay. I'm waiting for the applause. First of all, I'm disappointed by the lack of reception, but I think all of us as media professors understand the importance of assuaging our vanity by recording this for posterity. I did want to mention this is my fourth time at Poynter, and you can imagine the challenges in putting an inaugural event like this together. And before anyone has to leave for their planes, obviously the one thing that we need to do in public, chronicling it for posterity, is to thank the faculty and Jeannie for a seamless transition for a first annual event. They did an outstanding job. And with that, why, here he is. Guy Real.
Yeah.
Where's my applause? Anyway, this will look great. This will be on the first page of my annual report this year. But this is, I'll be back next year, and fantastic job, you guys. Just can't say it.
Bravo, I'm pronouncing my name correctly. This has been a great time for me, and I look forward to coming back again. Thanks for all of your generosity. I'm just overwhelmed with how willing people are to share what is theirs with others. And so thanks so much. And our next person is Ted Gelter. Reconnecting with old friends, meeting new ones, and I know that I have now been properly Poynter proselytized. Next is Chris Allen.
Thank you. This is my second time at Poynter, and I'm staying on for a little remedial instruction as well. I can't think of a better way to get recharged for the school year. I've learned things from everything from curriculum. We're undergoing curriculum reform. And it's great to have some ideas affirmed and to have some new ideas presented that we hadn't thought of. And of course, content. The mass common public opinion will never look the same again because of some things that I've learned here. Thanks, Al, for this, the great idea of this, to Jeannie for taking care of all of us, and good luck to everybody in the coming school year. Bonnie Jeffries.
I live here. I mean, not in the building. So this is probably my 50th time in the building, bringing student groups down and attending functions right here in the Great Hall. The Poynter Institute is really a community partner in the town and local educational institutions as well. This is my first Poynter seminar, though. I've had a fabulous time, so thanks very much. Paula.
Couple quick comments. First, it seemed to have trouble with names. And my first comment is Paula Horvath Niemeyer. Never hyphenate your name, even if you're in love. That's just my comment. My other comment is I want to thank the Poynter. Every time I come here, I think there is no way they can cram more information into a seminar, and they do. They prove me wrong every time. Thank you very much for everything you've given us. Omar Harbison.
Well, this is my first time here at Poynter, and I want to thank Ron Thomas, my director, for making it possible for me to be here. And I have been so inspired by each of you, the faculty here. This has been a rich experience, and I'm going to take a lot and teach it back with me. Thank you so much. Suzanne Gubon.
I also want to say that I've got a Michelle Bachman-sized headache. Because I've just learned way too much in a short amount of time. And also, I just want to give a big shout out to the state of New York today and all those people that are getting to share their lives together in matrimony. It's a big day.
This would be Marty.
Well, it's been a very inspiring weekend, and as with everybody else, I'm kind of suffering with hard drive overfill right now, but I have a lot to take back to San Francisco, and I'd like to thank the faculty and the staff, and especially our den mother, Jeannie, for all that she's done. And of the many things I've learned this weekend, one is this two-word mantra that we have become quite aware of and use quite a bit, and I'm going to use it all the time in the city, and every time I use it, I'm going to be thinking of all of you. So how about one last teach it?
Kelly McCurley. God, and I feel like this is like the shrine of the new drive. It's my first time here. And I'd like to thank everybody. I'd like to thank Jenny, my colleague Jenny Spinner, for talking to me and coming here. Although it wasn't that hard because it was 104 in Philadelphia yesterday. But thanks, Jenny. Thank you all. Herbert Lowe.
Change that is across our entire curriculum. So I thank you all, and I look forward to future communication, learning more from you, and just many of you will be hearing from me, because I want more. Thank you. And the next one is Randall King.
I guess we have the right to remain silent, but faculty always have something to say. I've been trying to get to Poynter for about 15 years, so I'm glad that Peach Palooza came along at the right time in my schedule. I can't think of a better thing that I enjoy doing much more than getting together with very, very smart people who do what we do and talk about the future issues and how we do a better job for students. It's especially great to do that and know that you don't have to take a faculty vote at the end of the process. Very, very wonderful. I'm going to be encouraging my colleagues to come back. Next name is Young Soo Kim.
One of the best person who ever pronounced my name. Thank you very much. And I want to thank to the pointer for giving this wonderful opportunity. And then I want to thank to everybody in here, staying with me, spending time with me. Thank you very much. By the way, I worried about if I pay, it's because not many persons do. Mark Johnson?
I can duck down here, so it's easier if you get the full experience. This is my second time coming to Pointer, and when I came here for the first time 4 years ago, I sort of felt like it was a reunion of old friends because I've been reading Al's morning emails for a decade at that point in time. And then when my boss said I could come back a second time, I figured this is great. I get to actually see the person I thought I knew when I actually know him. And then a very strange thing happened. As the emails were bouncing around about taxis, I saw a name that I hadn't seen in 20 years. And some of you figured this out. Jill and I went to Syracuse University together and hadn't seen each other since 1990. And we were editors together at student newspapers, so it's sort of three rounds of old friends. And what I'm going to take away from this is the idea that I think we should all go back and resign our jobs and form a new journalism college of just the 60 of us.
The problem is funded, Mark.
I'm sure if we search around in the back of taxi cabs on the way to hotels, we can find some quarters and dimes and things like that. So next up is Chioma.
First time here, and I really enjoyed it, and I promise you.